This is the New School for Social Research. I'm Duncan Foley, and we're picking up after spring break in this course, Advanced Microeconomics 2, Information and Behavior in Political Economy. And because we've been away for a week, I'm going to just run the camera backwards a little bit to catch up with exactly where we are so we have clearly in mind what we're talking about. So this is the second time for lecture six, this lecture six. I think I might be able to finish, although there's a lot of material in here, and if you and a lot of new material in here. So if we need to take a little bit longer to work through this, we can let this spill over to one more class without any problems. The theme of this lecture six is to apply these basic tools, the social interaction model and the entropy-constrained behavior model, to problems in classical political economy, that is mostly Adam Smith, but also the way that Marx read Adam Smith, or that I see Marx as having read Adam Smith. And it turns out that they have, there's quite a lot that can be said about these basic political economy problems from this point of view. Just to review very, very rapidly, Adam Smith starts out his discussion with the idea of an independent producer who has to choose what sector of production to go into. So there's already an idea that there's a division of sectors of production, and that the choice that an individual has is which sector to specialize in. So that's why the division of labor in Adam Smith is a picture of specialized division of labor. You'll notice that that is not what you typically get in intermediate microeconomic theory, because in intermediate microeconomic theory, the typical household is not deciding which thing to specialize in, usually. It's deciding how much of its time to allocate to different lines of production. And the reason for that is that the assumption, often implicit assumption, of conventional economics is that the individual production technology is convex, so that it's possible to diversify and do a little bit of everything and still get someplace. I'm going to try to argue that even starting with Adam Smith, that's not the way the classical political economist, and certainly not the way that Marx thought about this problem. And the real punchline of this lecture and these slides is that it makes a big difference. That is, it's not this difference between convexity and non-convexity and specialization and diversification is not just a technical issue that can be sort of ignored or approximated around, but that it makes very fundamental qualitative difference to the conclusions of the theory. And that's a thread that I hope I can bring out, and I'd be welcome questions to clarify it. In order to make this vision tractable, we need to be more specific about it. So we need a specific model. And the specific model that I'm going to use, which is certainly not the only possible one, but it's one that's consistent and has enough structure that you can actually get some results in it, so it's interesting in that respect, is what I call this hub and spoke model. And the idea here is that there's a fixed, probably large number of individual producers, which we'll call that number N, and that these producers require K different products. So we really want to keep clearly in mind the difference between N, the total number of producers, and K, the different product lines, as either inputs to production or as part of their consumption plan. And we're going to assume that, to make things very simple and to make the math as easy as possible, that the producers require the products in strict proportions. So they're complements. They're strict complements in the language of ordinary choice theory, perfect complements. And we're going to choose the units in which we measure the quantities of products so that the ratios in which they're required are just one-to-one. So we don't have a vector of weights that we have to stick into this payoff function in order to have it make sense. The payoff function just is the minimum of the quantities consumed of each of the K factors of production. This should be actually be a K here. Each of these products is a good. We can think of it as a product because somebody has to produce it, or you can think of it as a good because the more of it, the better, at least the more of all of them together, the better, because of the minimum assumption. And we're assuming all of the independent producers have access to the same technology of production. And this is a very simple technology that just has two alternatives. One is the producer can diversify and produce all the products herself, in which case she produces the output bundle 1, 1, 1, 1. And if she does that, then her payoff is 1, right? Because the minimum of 1, 1, 1, 1 is 1, and that's the payoff function. So she gets a payoff which is normalized to be 1. Or the producer can specialize in the production of one good. So you have to choose one, only one. And specialization requires effort, which the typical individual producer views as equivalent to sigma times, that's the Greek letter sigma, sigma times the payoff from diversification. So she has to pay an effort. She doesn't like to specialize. Specialization has some negative aspects to it, but she will do it. And if she does it, she produces a lot of the good that she decides to specialize in. In fact, more than 1 plus sigma times k units of the good. And the reason that that is important is that that condition is what makes it socially rational for the society to specialize rather than diversify, because the payoff for specialization is higher than the payoff for diversification. The hub in this language is diversified production. That's where you go to the middle and you do a little of everything. You become a jack of all trades or a self-sufficient farm, but you live at a low standard of living. And the spokes are these individual lines of production in which you can specialize. But when you specialize, you've got a dilemma, because what you have is only one, when you're finished producing, is you only have one product. And you can't survive with just one product. You need the whole collection of products in order to consume and survive. The reason that this is interesting, as I said, basically has some economic interest, is that under these assumptions, there's a social coordination problem. And the social coordination problem arises because it's advantageous for the producers to divide themselves up into teams of K producers. And each of the K producers goes to one of the spokes and does one of the products. And then they share the result among themselves. If you could imagine, if you can figure out an institutional way to achieve that, then the producers are better off specializing than they are diversifying. And the reason for this condition that A should be bigger than 1 plus sigma times K is to make sure that the payoff to that kind of specialization, if you specialize and just pile up all the goods in the middle and then divide them equally, that that is going to be better than everybody diversifying for the typical producer. And it's pretty transparent what's going on and why there's an advantage, at least a potential advantage, to specialization. The reason that this is important in political economy is because it's not easy to figure out institutional ways to achieve that potential advantage. And that's what we're going to be talking about in considerable detail today, is why that question leads us to a theory of money, to a theory of exchange, to a theory of commodities, and to some interesting results about how close you can come to the socially coordinated outcome with the kind of institutions that Adam Smith and Marx argue are implicit in this setup. Just for notational purposes, we're going to assume that the number of producers is an even multiple of the number of products, so that you can divide up effectively into the right number of teams. I mean, if you were going to do more complicated math here, you'd have to deal with what happened when didn't quite divide up and so forth. But let's leave that away for the moment. Okay, and here's a little picture of the idea where the hub is diversification, the circle in the middle, and then the spokes are the different lines of specialization that a producer might choose. Okay, does anybody have any clarifying question on the hub and spoke model? Esben.
I just have a question in relation to the premise for specialization. You said today in your kind of summary that specialization has this negative thing to it.
Yes, and there's effort cost to
okay,
it.
Okay, then I have no question.
Right. So you get a higher productivity, but it's offset against the effort cost.
It's just an investment in the specialization.
But we're assuming that the productivity advantage is sufficiently large so that in principle it can overcome the effort cost. Advait, over here. No, Justin, and then I'll go since we got the microphone here.
So how are we assuming that the specializations integrate themselves?
That's what the whole purpose of this lecture is, to discuss different ways that that might happen. Okay. I mean, conceptually, I'm supposed to repeat the questions for the filming. So Justin asked, how is this supposed to actually work institutionally? That is, how can you specialize and then redistribute the product so that everybody gets this advantage, right? And I'm saying that's exactly what the subject of this lecture is. And it goes, in my view, to the heart, that's really the heart of political economy. That's really what Smith was interested in. And it's the implicit question behind political economy, that is, what relations of distribution are what we would now call incentive compatible with specialization in such a way that the whole thing will hang together and it'll work. Is that Advait? Yeah.
Professor, I just wanted to ask small clarifying question about the assumption A is greater than K times 1 plus sigma, and
yes.
And what mm-hmm. that means? Could you just go
Well, what it means is that if everybody, here you can see it right here, if everybody specializes, they each produce A of their own product, they have to divide that up among their team. So everybody winds up with A divided by K of the actual products. And they all pay an effort, so their payoff just from the products is A over K. They pay an effort cost of sigma. So if A over K minus sigma, we want that to be bigger than 1, which is the diversification payoff, so that there's an incentive to specialize, in principle. Okay. Now we talked in the last class some about what I called spontaneous socialism, and that is whether there was any possibility that you could get this kind of sharing, specialization and sharing, spontaneously as the equilibrium of a game. And we looked at the conditions for that, and we found out that in this very simple model you can actually answer that question in terms of different relations between the productivity advantage A and the number of individuals, the scale of the system, and also K, the complexity of the system in terms of the number of different products. And I'm not going to go over that because we did that in some detail. And you can go back and review the notes. But one thing that we want to take away from that is that it's a good example of the methodology of the social interaction model. What we have to do is, if we think that there's a strategy or a action, such as specialize and share, which would be the spontaneous socialist action, if we think that that's an equilibrium, we have to test whether it's an equilibrium. And in the social interaction model, that basically means asking the question, is that a best response to itself? If everybody else is doing it, are there incentives there for the typical other producer, pick one at random, to keep doing it too? And we saw that that was not always true in the spontaneous socialism case, that for a wide intervening range of productivities, either that the spontaneous socialist action was not a best response to itself because it tempted the individual producer to free ride by diversifying and not participating in the overall exchange, and that that would still give that producer a higher payoff. So that ruins that prevents it from being in equilibrium. Now, that's very important to keep in mind because that's the paradigmatic template for the kind of argument that we're going to go through from now on with this. Adam Smith clearly envisions, and if you read the first book of Wealth of Nations, which is what this is about, and it's not a very long book, and it's written in such a way that it's hard not to read it once you start reading it practically. Imposes itself on you. Adam Smith is interested in fact, he only discusses the possibility along the lines of Justin's question, that the division of labor is going to be sustained by private property in the outputs and by quid pro quo exchange. So spontaneous socialism is not quid pro quo exchange. In spontaneous socialism, you produce and you share your product regardless, not conditionally, unconditionally, regardless of what other people do. For Adam Smith, the focus is on quid pro quo exchange. Each producer in the Smith story is free to choose her own line of specialized production or to diversify and remain self-sufficient. But instead of the sharing model, each producer now is going to take after production, is going to bargain with the other producers in order to make exchanges or trades or transactions, quid pro quo transactions, to redistribute the product. And the question then is, will that work to answer Justin's question? That is, will that type of exchange sustain the socially coordinated equilibrium? Well, you really have two questions. One, the socially coordinated equilibrium is the kind of ideal best or optimum, but it still might be that it works well enough to be a lot better than diversification, which, so we really have to keep our eyes on two questions. One is, does it work well enough to get you a higher payoff, a higher standard of living, or higher social payoff than diversification? And the second is, how close can it come to the full socially coordinated outcome, which traditional mainstream economics would call the Pareto efficient or Pareto optimal outcome. In this system, Smith observed, there's a distinction between use value and exchange value. So it's interesting that this comes up right away in this hub and spoke model and in a very transparent way, the language. The reason is, when you've produced, if you're a specialized producer in the hub and spoke model, you've produced a lot of shoes or housing or clothes or whatever it is you've specialized in, but you've produced way more than you can use. So your product is not of any use to you at the margin or effectively. It's only useful in this exchange model because you can use it to do quid pro quo exchanges to get the other goods that you need. So you got this immediate distinction between use value and exchange value, which does not occur, for example, in the spontaneous socialism case. There's only use values in the spontaneous socialism case because there's no exchange. The products have the same use value whether they're produced with a diversified technology or through specialization, so there's no difference there. It's just that you get more of it if the economy specializes. Potentially, everybody gets more, and that's the important idea. Marx calls this system commodity production. And he says the characteristic of commodity production is specialization, division of labor sustained through specialization, and distribution through quid pro quo exchange. That is the exchange of the products as the private property of the direct producers. So the direct producers have the right to refuse to give it to somebody else if they don't reach a bargain that they like. Okay, so that's what Marx calls commodity production. It's interesting, and it would be worth spending more time on, but this is not primarily a course about Marx, but it's because I think people are interested in Marx, to notice that Marx views commodity production as irrational. He says this over and over again. And in this context, it's worth, I think, asking what he might have meant by that. Because it doesn't seem as though the coordinated specialized division of labor is irrational. In fact, that just seems very rational. That's sandbox things, right? I mean, if you have this option of dividing up into the teams and then sharing everything, and you're going to get more that way, what's irrational about doing that? It's only rational to do it. So what Marx must have meant, I think, when he said commodity production was irrational, was not that the division of labor per se is irrational. What he means is that the attempt to sustain the division of labor through the exchange of products as commodities is irrational. And the reason he thinks it's irrational is because when you exchange commodities, when you exchange products as commodities, there's essentially an antagonistic relationship between the two parties to the exchange. Each party has the interest in maximizing the amount they get and minimizing the amount that they give, right? So there, which is the core of the Edgeworth box in standard microeconomic theory and all of those constructions. And Marx argued, well, that's irrational because really what's going on here is that there's a shared interest. There's a shared interest in everybody specializing and then somehow redistributing the product so that everybody gets the benefit from the specialization. And what's irrational to Marx is the antagonistic relation of exchange, not the specialization itself, I would argue. Maybe some people will have some second thoughts on that, but we can talk about that in a moment. What's going on here, from Marx's point of view, and this is very characteristic of these social interaction models, you see, is that the typical producer, let's say it's Robinson Crusoe. Robinson Crusoe doesn't have any social coordination problem. Robinson Crusoe just has an allocation problem. He has to decide how much of his time as a diversified producer to spend on producing clothes, shoes, housing, whatever it is. But now the social relations of commodity production have effectively split Robinson Crusoe, or the typical producer, into two personae. A producer who has too much of whatever she produced, and a consumer who has too little of everything else. Okay, so all of a sudden what was a unified, from a certain point of view, was a unified social phenomenon, namely production and consumption, has now somehow got itself split up into these antagonistic pieces. And one of the basic points of the social interaction model is that the typical producer, if you have a large society with a lot of division of labor, has no direct interaction with the other specialized producers of the same good. And the interactions with the other producers are entirely mediated through exchange and through the commodity relationship. And this is in spite of the fact that we have set this up so that all of these producers are exactly the same, right? They all have exactly the same interests, exactly the same technological possibilities, and so forth. But now exchange has created these antagonistic relationships. Okay, well, what's the simplest way that you might do this? It's barter. And we'll talk a little bit about barter, but I'm not going to spend a lot of time on barter for a reason which I will explain to you in just a moment. But let's just, in order to get our thinking going about this, stop and think about how this would work with barter. The barter system, the typical producer starts with her own output of her specialized commodity and no other products. So you might think that then she somehow interacts with producers of other products through transactions. So what kind of transactions are these going to be? Well, she meets another producer whose product she does not have. So this is something she hasn't acquired yet, and who does not have her product. And that's a very significant condition, because that's what's called the double coincidence of wants. I meet you. I have something you don't have and therefore want. You have something I don't have and therefore want. So there's a double coincidence of wants. And what are they going to do? Well, the simplest thing would be for them just to not spend a whole lot of time haggling, but realizing the symmetry of the situation, just exchange 1 over k of their products with each other. So I know you have this big stash of shoes. You know I have this big stash of food. I give you 1 over k of my food. You give me 1 over k of your shoes. Okay? And that's a barter transaction. Incidentally, you'll notice that it's going to be a value balancing transaction if the values are all the same, which basically is the labor theory of value in this setting. But two producers with barter cannot transact if either one already holds the product of the other. Because the rule of barter is that you never accept something in exchange for your product in excess of what you need. So if you already have it, you won't trade in barter. In fact, I'm going to argue in a moment that the characteristic of a monetary transaction is precisely that with money, people will accept more of the money commodity than they need. So they'll allow themselves to take the money commodity even if they already have it. And that's really what the key element in moneyness or monetary transactions is. But let's follow out the barter story a little bit more. What you can see is going to happen is that at the beginning of barter, it's going to be very easy to make exchanges, right? Because everybody starts with a whole lot of their own product and nothing of anything else. So almost every time they meet somebody, unless the person they meet is a producer of their same product, they're going to be able to make a transaction. But as this process goes on, it's going to become more and more difficult to make transactions. because more and more of the people that you happen to meet will already have transacted for your particular product. And in fact, you can see that finishing up the last little piece of the puzzle, getting that Kth commodity, just the last piece of the jigsaw puzzle that fills in your quota, could be very difficult indeed. You know it's possible because you can add up, if we're God or something or economist, you can add up all the commodities, and you know that if one agent has a deficiency of a commodity, some other agent has to have the surplus, the corresponding surplus. I go to a chamber music conference in the summers where we mostly play string quartets. And the big problem of string quartet playing is you got to get two violins, a viola, and a cello to make a string quartet. And there's a lot of anxiety about what's called free play and whether you're going to get a group together in the afternoon after the coaching is over with. But if you stop and think about it, because in fact they admit an even number of string quartets, you know that there always has to be a potential group, as long as somebody isn't going swimming or something like that instead of playing string quartets, which as a result, cellists who are seen going to the lake for a swim are often subject to severe criticism from the other players because they're, unless a whole string quartet goes swimming together, then it doesn't matter. Well, what's wrong with this system? The problem is that if transactions are costly, and one would imagine that they are costly, now we have to not only do this accounting of how much you can produce, and how much effort costs the sigma, but we're now also going to have to take account of the time and trouble you spend matching up all of these transactions as a producer. And that, in a complex economy, could be very, very substantial. If you stop and think about all the different things that you yourself consume, if you had to find an individual counterparty for for apples and pears and shoes and every single thing that you needed, you would be spending a lot of time in the transactions process. And that would dissipate much of the advantage, and maybe even all of the advantage of the specialization, the productivity specialization. This has led, incidentally, to a considerable number of economics papers that try to work through the combinatorics of barter and other exchanges. And if you're interested in that, you can look into that. You can look into that literature. But in fact, from a political economy point of view, there's very little interest in barter. And that's an important point. And I believe the reason that there's not very much interest on the part of Adam Smith or Marx in barter, in the mechanics of barter, is because they both believed the barter exchange was unstable in the sense of the social interaction model. And in particular, that it would always devolve into monetary exchange. So the next part of what I want to talk about is just to sketch that general idea. Jose.
Yes. I want you to elaborate a little bit on that last statement that barter devolves into monetary exchange. Does that mean that the money commodity arises from a barter system?
So Jose's question is, does it mean that a money commodity arises from a barter system? And to answer that question properly, we have to go back to the discussion that we had about explanation in the social interaction model, and in particular conventions, assurance game kind of situations, right? Where we know that the equilibrium is always at one of the extremes or the other. Either everybody does the thing or nobody does the thing. Remember we talked about the computer operating system kind of game, where everybody does it or nobody does it. And that's the kind of causal connection there is between barter and money. Either everybody chooses the same money commodity, accepts one commodity above and beyond their needs for it, which is then the money commodity, it's the socially accepted general equivalent, or nobody does. Now, whether you could then ever trace, but this is not an anthropological kind of causation. It's not as though people actually might have been there trying to do these barter transactions, although maybe you can find some evidence of that in some historical cases. But I think what both Smith and Marx are arguing was that by and large you won't find that evidence because those are unstable arrangements and therefore you hardly ever see them. Barter arrangements are unstable and therefore what you almost always see is a monetary arrangement.
But still the money commodity will rise due to the need to solve the double coincidence of wants problem.
Okay, now Jose says, is that because there's a need to solve the double coincidence of wants? I think that's a misleading way to think about it. Because who needs to solve the double coincidence of wants? The economist needs to solve it, not the producers. Okay. What the producers need to solve is how can they turn their product, which they have the surplus of, into the balanced vector of products that they need to consume. That's their problem. And it turns out that in a monetary economy, it's always better, it's always easier to do that by using money as a medium of exchange. So the problem that the individual is solving is not the double coincidence of wants problem. The problem the individual is solving is the practical problem of how do you get from specialized production to meeting your needs. Now, I don't know if that's these are very murky and tricky areas, and I don't know if this is going to satisfy you, but that's what I'm going to try to get you to swallow today. But let me go a little bit further, because it's along these lines that the next few slides try to develop the argument. Here's, and I think, and from my reading of both Adam Smith and Marx, this is what they thought. I think in both cases, the language that they used, Adam Smith's language, I think, is easier and more available to us than Marx's language for a couple of reasons. But the language that they use makes it, some cases, a little difficult to understand this, but I urge you to go back and look, for example, at the first chapter of volume one of Capital, which goes through this question of the emergence of money, and see how well you think it fits this, or this story fits it. It fits this story, or this story fits it. But here's the scenario. Suppose one producer decides to accept either commodity she needs, so she's still willing to do barter, okay? Or some particular commodity, say the first, actually it turns out to be the kth later in the notes, but anyway, it's got to be one of them, whether she needs it or not in exchange for her product. So you see that the distinction here is not that she will only accept money, she'll accept anything as long as she needs it. What's characteristic of monetary exchange is that she'll accept the money, one of these commodities, in excess of what she needs. Now, this slight change in the barter system will probably make little difference to an isolated individual producer. She'll find it slightly easier to sell her product because she has relaxed one of the constraints of the barter system a little bit. But if everybody else is still doing barter, it's not going to make that much difference because just as my string quartet example made clear, if you're the only one doing this, then you don't get any advantage from it. Because everybody else is still going to demand a double coincidence of ones. And just because you don't, you're not getting very much advantage from it. But think about this from the social interaction point of view. The more individual producers decide to accept one commodity, let's say it's the first commodity, in excess of their needs in exchange for their own product, the higher the payoff to any other producer who makes that same decision is going to be. So if you know there are a lot of people out there who are always willing to accept one commodity, so you can just count on that, then it's much to your advantage to accept that same commodity, whether you need it or not. Because then you do get a big leverage, a big multiplier in the social, in overcoming the double coincidence of wants problem. In fact, if everybody else will accept one commodity in excess of what they need, so it's become a socially accepted general equivalent or a money commodity in Marx's sense, then you would have to be crazy not to do it yourself. Right? Because what do you lose? You know that if you accept the money commodity, you can always use it to buy the commodities that you need from somebody else, because everybody else is accepting it. So why wouldn't you accept it? Be absolutely no reason. Now you see, this is this classic assurance game or convention type of application of the social interaction model. The equilibrium, the polymorphic equilibrium, the one in the middle, is unstable. You don't know which commodity is going to become the money commodity at this level of reason. Might be any of the commodities. But just as we knew that either the Windows operating system or the Linux operating system was going to become the universal standard in the operating system network externality model, we know that one commodity is going to win out in any particular community or sphere of exchangers and become the stable outcome. So in the terminology of the social interaction model, there's a strong strategic complementarity associated with the action of accepting one particular commodity in exchange for a producer's specialized commodity, even if she already has more of that commodity than she needs. Okay, so I would argue that what this is telling you is that if specialized producers in the hub and spoke model are choosing between specialization and exchange through barter on the one hand, and specialization and exchange through barter and the acceptance of one particular commodity in excess of their needs, strategic complementarity makes the barter equilibrium unstable. It's not that it's not an equilibrium. It's an equilibrium, but it's one of those interior unstable equilibria that arises when you have strong strategic complementarity. And therefore, we would predict very strongly that there's going to be a money commodity. We may not know which commodity is going to emerge as the money commodity, but there's going to be one that emerges in this kind of system. Marx describes the money commodity as the socially accepted general equivalent, which if you just unpack the ordinary meaning of those words, that's pretty much exactly what I just described, right? Socially means it's everybody's doing it. General equivalent means everybody will accept that commodity in exchange for their specialized output. Okay, so the bottom line of this discussion is that this is an example of the social interaction model where of a kind of network externality version of the social interaction model, where you know one commodity is going to win out as the money commodity, although you may not know which one. So it's path dependent. This is important. This is an important feature of these kinds of explanations. The explanation is very strong on saying one of the options is going to win out. It's not very good at saying which one is going to win out. Which action is going to win out? Now let's think about some of the implications of this before we try to apply it to how it might work in the hub and spoke model. The emergence of money does not necessarily suppress barter altogether. The money, the choice of money does not say you would refuse barter transactions. It just says you're willing also always to do a money transaction. Richard, you have a question? Do we have the mic?
Thank you. Nowadays, we have a mining commodity, or we have something more fantastic, fiction commodity.
I'm going to explain that in a. The question is: nowadays, do we have a commodity money, or do we have a fictional money? I think is maybe the term you used. I'm going to address that on one or two slides later. So I'd really rather just wait until that comes along. But let's look at this first group of implications. The emergence of money does not suppress barter altogether. The producers are still willing to do barter if it happens that they hit a double coincidence of ones. That's fine. But it does tend to relegate barter transactions to a minor part of economic production and distribution. So that's the first thing to be clear about. The issue is not to get rid of barter altogether. It's that the money exchange overwhelms it. But think about what happens now in terms of these social interaction stories. Once money is widely used, the typical producer now undergoes another split. So you can see what's starting to happen is that the typical producer, who started off as Robinson Crusoe, who is the model of mental health and lack of alienation, he is lonely, but he is not alienated. If you read Defoe's novel of Robinson Crusoe, Robinson Crusoe is a very cheerful, organized kind of guy, and he's certainly not alienated. But now we're getting these splits. Now the typical producer, first of all, got exploded out of the hub and into one of these spokes, right? Where she sees the exact scale model of herself at each of the other spokes, but she has no way to directly communicate with those other versions of herself. Then exchange splits her again into a buyer and seller. And now money produces even another split precisely into, are you selling your commodity for money? And that's one asymmetrical condition. Or are you buying something you need with money, which is a totally different point of view. Each of these splits opens up the possibility of a social coordination problem due to the fact, for example, that the typical producer as seller cannot directly coordinate with the other producers as buyers. If she could directly coordinate, then they could make a deal which would reach the social coordination outcome, right? But in fact, they can't do that because they have to interact just as individuals. Marx expresses this by saying that the separation of sale and purchase introduces what he calls the possibility of crisis. Might be not enough people who want to buy, not enough buyers, or something of that kind, depending on the exact circumstances. So from this point of view, the principle Keynes made famous as Say's Law amounts to the assumption that some mechanism exists to overcome the social coordination problem that's inherent in the separation of sale and purchase in monetary economies. Now, just because Richard asked this question, let me go forward and then maybe we'll take a little time out. In the real world, there's a variety of concrete factors that influence which commodity emerges as money. One set of factors have to do with the properties of particular products. And you find this in the older textbooks all the time. So there's a big section of monetary textbooks on why precious metals, because they're divisible and it's easy to, relatively easy to assay them and test whether it really is gold or silver or whatever it might be by chemical tests and things like that, and they're fairly durable. Why those things are particularly well suited to be money commodities. But we know, in fact, that a lot of different stuff emerges as money commodities. A very famous example is this thing of cigarettes in concentration camps and other circumstances like that. And if you want to, that's a very interesting literature to read, and it is clearly telling you exactly the story. And it's interesting because people would also smoke the cigarettes. So they were both a use value and an exchange value and a medium of exchange. Now, exactly how you decided when it was worth smoking a cigarette, which would be like lighting up a $10 bill, right? You might, if you got some good insight into that, you might understand a little bit better what's going on with liquidity preference and other issues in modern economies. Which commodity emerges as money in a particular economy can also depend on socially coordinated decisions. Well, one of the main social coordinations is the policy of the state, of kings or political leaders, because they may designate a particular commodity as money. This is a this happens historically, and it's the focus of a lot of attention of what's called the chartalist school of monetary theory, modern monetary theory. There are a few curious cases where sectors of economies insist on using a different money. This is almost like little enclaves that insist on speaking a different language, which also is a phenomenon that occasionally happens due to the dynamics of these strategic complementarities. And along with the emergence of money, you almost always see the emergence of some kind of credit due to deferred payment. So in many cases, an awful lot of transactions are actually accomplished without the exchange of the money commodity at all. People make what are called tally sticks. So, you know, you and I, so we mark a stick which tells how much you owe and who and how much I owe, and the stick gets split apart into two pieces. I'm the creditor, I have one piece, you're the debtor, you have the other piece. And if I come after you and with my piece, then you have to come up with the payment. On the other hand, if enough sticks match up, you know, through a complicated network, it might be that they're like a clearinghouse, might be that very little of the money commodity changes hands at all. Finally, now we get to Richard's question. There's no theoretical reason why money necessarily has to be a produced commodity. The main requirements for an asset or liability to function as money are that it be exchangeable against produced commodities, so it has to be ownable, and so forth, that it be hard to counterfeit, because if everybody can produce their own money then easily, then it's no good, right? The whole point of the money commodity is that the only way you can get it is by selling something to somebody else on the whole, unless you're the producer of the money commodity, but then you have to put out the effort to produce it. and that it be generally accepted. In the 20th century, in almost all advanced capitalist countries, the debt of the state came to be used as money. The acceptability of liquid state debts, such as reserve accounts of central banks, is strongly supported by the fact that they can be used to settle tax liabilities. So almost everybody in the modern economy has a tax liability, and the fact that the Treasury has to accept its own money as satisfying the tax liability greatly increases the general acceptability of the debts of the state. So I would say it's something of a misnomer. You use the term fictional money to call state debt money fiat money or fictional money. It's not a fiction at all. It's a definite result of a definite economic transaction that leaves the state owing money to the public. And the fiat idea suggests that the money asset is widely acceptable simply because the state says so. That is, that the state is using its powers of compulsion to make something money. But that's not really what's going on. What's going on is essentially this same strategic complementarity convention that we've been talking about. It's just that now it's centered and focused on the state debt. Now, it may be that the state has a big influence in that. For example, when in the 1930s, when gold coins still circulated in the United States, gold and silver specie it was called, still circulated in the United States, the New Deal decided that it wanted to move to what it viewed as a more rational managed money system in which it would be the reserve accounts at the Federal Reserve that would function as money, not gold coins. And so they passed legislation to make it illegal to use gold coins in domestic transactions. Now that's clearly trying to push the equilibrium in a certain direction, right? So I'm not saying you can't push the equilibrium in a certain direction if you're somebody like the state. What I'm saying is you can't push the equilibrium in a certain direction if you're just one of the many participants in a social interaction model. If you personally decide that you're going to operate with a silver coin standard and everybody else is using dollar bills, you're not going to get very far. Actually, there's some very funny stories about that, about these luxury stores like Tiffany's, which opened up at a certain time when there's a big gold fever. They will open up a little corner of their store where a guy is sitting there with scales and will weigh gold dust and give you credit against the gold dust right there in the store if you came shopping with gold dust instead of with cash. But I have a feeling this, to me, gets more into the fantasy fiction element, I think, much more closely. If you're interested in the historical account of this transition, I think a very good place to start is the book of Yakat Ahamed's called Lords of Finance, which is a history of the transition away from the gold standard after the First World War and the inability of a group of central bankers to restore the gold standard, despite the fact that they all insisted that that was their policy objective. So it's an interesting example of unintended consequences, but it's also a very important it's also a very important historical episode. What happened, just to summarize it very briefly, was that after the First World War, the United States had a huge amount of gold. Because during the war crisis, many people shipped their gold to the U.S. or sold gold to the U.S. as a place of safekeeping. Now, if you're going to run the gold standard, you know that the basic principle of the gold standard is that the country that has all the gold is supposed to do what? you're Hume. Supposed to have a big inflation, right? All that gold is supposed to be allowed to expand the domestic money supply and create an inflation to push up prices in that country that has a lot of gold. And that's going to lead the gold to be able to flow out to the countries that don't have very much gold, which are under deflationary pressure, right? So you, the whole thing is supposed to balance that way. Well, the person who's the sort of protagonist of this Lords of Finance book, who was running American monetary policy at that time, was not actually the chairman of the Fed. It was the president of the New York Federal Reserve Bank, and his name was Benjamin Strong up until 1920. His death, early death in 1927. Strong realized that he had this choice, which was that if he allowed these inflows of gold to expand reserves and expand the money supply, there was going to be a whopping big inflation in the United States. And for a variety of reasons, Strong didn't want to have a big inflation in the United States. So he further discovered that he could do what's called sterilize the gold inflows by selling government bonds to offset the purchases of gold in order to keep the inflows of gold from expanding the reserves of the banking system, which he did. And it worked. Now, it didn't work, you know, to the last decimal point, but it basically worked. And is the origins of what we now call inflation targeting monetary policy, which has been the tradition that's developed in one way or another ever since then. Major discussion of money and the emergence of money, I wanted to see if there were any questions about that. We could also take some questions later, but Marjan has a question.
I was wondering, how much can we explain the very first stage that the producer decide to shift from barter to the exchange of monetary money commodity by the fact that, by the information cost of information. So how much weight can we put on the information cost?
Yeah, well, that's a, okay, Marjan asks, what about the very initial stage where producers are faced with the choice of diversification or participating in a specialized division of labor, and what's the role of information in that, is what you're asking. Well, I would say you can't have barter until you have, barter is a part of exchange. So in terms of the logic of the thing, exchange comes out of specialization. If you have diversification, you're not going to have very much exchange. You might have a little bit, as Marx says, around the edges. So you might have self-sufficient production units, and any one year, one production unit has more apples, and the other one has more honey, so they can exchange apples for honey, but the next year it might turn around and be just the opposite, right? So that's really not what we're talking about, because that doesn't lead to specialization.
In the sense of like finding the very last piece of jigsaw that you were talking about, so it becomes very hard to, like, if we want to have like the matching need, and I'm talking in that sense. Just if I just want to say that, so if we assume a society that there's no cost or just information is widely available for everyone, can we not having this shift from barter to using a monetary?
Well, if, okay, so then the question is, suppose there are no information costs at all. Well, in a way, if there's no information costs at all, why don't you just go directly to the socially coordinated outcome? Then you might as well go not to spontaneous socialism, but just to a centralized socialism where the commissars tell everybody what to do. But I think what you're asking is a little bit different, and at least it's an important question, which is that in our minds there's some idea of a history of all this, that there must have been occasions when people were choosing between specialization and diversification. Now, I would suggest, actually, that instead of thinking about that in terms of imaginary histories, because we really don't know a whole lot about the social relations. I mean, we know a fair amount. I mean, there's all these tablets and stuff from Babylonia and Linear B and all this kind of thing. But we don't have a lot of direct evidence about the deep history of these social relations of production. But we do have actually a lot of evidence about what's going on right now, because at any moment, there are a large number of people in the world who are choosing between diversification and specialization. Because a large part of the population of the world still basically operates in a diversified, more or less self-sufficient production system. And that choice has to do with all of the phenomena that are so dramatic in modern life: urbanization, proletarianization, immigration. All of those kinds of choices are deeply intertwined with this question in people's actual lives of diversification and specialization. So I have this feeling I didn't answer your question.
That's okay. I mean, it begs to some extent.
I answered another question. You're willing to. I didn't fill in the jigsaw puzzle piece by giving you the information you needed, but I gave you another piece of information you didn't need, which you're willing to accept as the equivalent of it. Here, Jose has a question.
I have two questions. The first one is a clarifying question. And you said that this division between buyers and sellers,
yeah,
that arises when a general equivalent arises in the economy, potentially causes coordination problems.
Yes.
That means that there is no guarantee that there are going to be coordination problems in the economy, right?
Okay, so I'm not sure I got your question. I understand where the question is focused. It's focused on the discussion of the idea that the emergence of money and monetary exchange creates a further division of the typical producer into a buyer and a seller. Mm-hmm. Because on the one hand, you're selling your specialized commodity for money, and on the other hand, you're turning around and using that money to buy the things that you need. And those two roles are not necessarily coordinated.
Mm-hmm.
That was what I had to do.
So that's the point. They're not necessarily coordinated, but they could be, potentially.
Well, of course, they could be, potentially, because if you were as Marjan said, if information costs were zero and you had some kind of Walrasian auctioneer or ministry of production of the socialist state in Barone's terms, you would... They could coordinate it, right? They could just say, you do this, and then you take your output and you give it to that person. And you're going to get your needs met by this other part of it.
And the other question that I had was, you emphasize a lot on the exchangeability that provides money as like the argument for it to rise in the system, right? But there are like accounts, like for example, you mentioned the Chartelist account that emphasizes more the debt or other characteristics of money. What is your take on that?
Well, I don't think there's any inconsistency between this general theory of the emergence of money and the Chartelist point of view. But I think I would get a stiff argument from some of the Chartelists if they were in the rooms. So I think I would get arguments from the Chartelists about that. But I would be willing to have that argument, and I don't think it's inconsistent. I think they put an emphasis on the role of the state in choosing which commodity or which asset is going to be money. And I don't think that is incompatible with this view, because there's this path dependency in all of these models which leaves a certain degree of freedom about which particular thing is going to happen. But I would still argue that that what's behind the monetary phenomenon in all cases is its universal acceptability. And the universal acceptability is very hard to explain except through strategic complementarity along the lines that I advise. That I outlined here.
Professor, there was a point when you mentioned a cost of, I mean, you identified two costs. One is the cost of specializing, and another is the cost of actually engaging in barter.
Yes.
And I wonder if we can, and that could be information, that could be the problem of running into the right person who has the commodity that you need. It could be all of those things that are seen as a cost before you can actually transact in the barter. I was wondering if, can we assume away all of that into the same sigma that we started out with as to, you know, this is all part of the problem of specialization. I mean,
okay. Advaita asked the very relevant question about the two different kinds of effort costs that I referred to. One is the sigma effort cost that has to do with specializing in production. But then I also, in a kind of a hand-waving way, invoked effort costs in transactions in discussing why barter was unstable and the difficulties of barter. But that was hand-waving, and if you want to do it, somebody could sit down and write a paper for this course or something where you use these same tools and just make that all that more explicit. And I think that would be a useful thing to do and might very well lead to a publishable piece of research. So, but I didn't do it. I agree. And I didn't do it because that would bog us down for maybe another 2 weeks or something. And there are many other things I want to talk about. So I was hoping to get you to...
Professor, there's another quick...
Accept that without all of the dots, all of the I's dotted and the T's crossed. Yeah.
There was another question that I had. I'm not sure if I'm playing the scenario out right, but There's an emergence, we speak of an emergence of a money commodity. So the way I see it, there's one individual who decides to accept more of any commodity in excess of what they need. And then we said, and you mentioned that barter will continue to sustain, if you find somebody, if there exists a double coincidence of wants, people will exchange, but there is already simultaneously the beginning of an emergence of a money commodity. Now, as soon as we speak of the beginning of a money commodity, we spoke about the payoffs as to if an individual starts to hold on to this money commodity, your payoff from holding on to that money commodity begins to increase. Now, as I see it, you will choose to only hold on to the money commodity and the barter system, I feel that it will not sustain at the same time. And given that there's a limited amount of the money commodity, because at the first production round, we all produced A, and now there's A over K available for everybody, the minute somebody starts to hold on to it, there's a decreasing quantity of it available. And I think that that will lead to a crisis where a certain part of the K individuals are not willing to buy anymore.
Okay. That is a hard question to summarize in a few words, but let me try. I heard two parts of it. One part is that Advaita is interested in the details of the dynamics of the emergence of the money commodity. And I do have something to say definitely about that. And the second part was that you were speculating on what the dynamics of monetary exchange might be like, and we're going to talk about that in a lot more detail in the next few slides. So I'd like to put that part off to the next few slides and see if it, because there are some quite specific things you can say along the lines that you were asking. On the question of the dynamics of the emergence of money, I tried to deal with this back of several lectures ago when we talked about causality and explanation in the social interaction model, and in particular in social interaction model with that was unstable, where beta was bigger than one. And the point about that is that it is very, very difficult to trace the exact dynamics by which one of those equilibria becomes dominant. I mean, you just don't see the polymorphic situation for very long. Because whatever disturbs it, whether it's a government policy or just the accidental order of adoption or whatever it is, when there's strong strategic complementarity, sets in motion such enormous social pressures that it becomes moot. You just don't care. I mean, you might have been a silver person, but if the economy's going gold, sooner or later you're going to have to give in. Okay, so I hope that. Okay, well let's see if we can go. I doubt that we'll be able to finish all of this, but let me start the next part, and we'll take this up at the next class. Smith, there's a very famous passage, or it should be extremely famous, maybe even more famous than it is, in Adam Smith, and I just wanted to read it because it seems to me that it was very influential to Marx, and it has a lot to do with the whole question of what the labor theory of value really is and what the content of the labor theory of value is. Smith says, "The whole of the advantages and disadvantages of the different employments of labor and stock." Now by stock he means what we call capital. So he's already thinking of an economy in which the means of production are appropriated as capital by a separate class. And we haven't really even gotten to discussing that case yet. We will discuss it in the next major lecture, which has to do with looking at the social interaction model with Marx. But he in this case, he's talking about both labor and capital, must in the same neighborhood be either perfectly equal or continually tending to equality. If in the same neighborhood, now by neighborhood, we have to think of you think of a neighborhood like Queens or something, I don't know, but that's a borough, it's not a neighborhood, but Park Slope. But what he means by neighborhood is clearly a sector of the economy where there is mobility of labor and capital. That's what he means by neighborhood. If in the same neighborhood there was any employment evidently either more or less advantageous than the rest, so many people would crowd into it in the one case and so many would desert it in the other, that its advantages would soon return to the level of other employments. So even before we have capitalist production and capital and means of production to become capital, we can still apply this reasoning to the movement of these independent producers among the different lines of production. This at least would be the case in a society where things were left to follow their natural course. Here's this great word, natural, which in my view always sets off huge alarm bells, ideological alarm bells. Their natural course, where there was perfect liberty and where every man was perfectly free both to choose what occupation he thought proper and to change it as often as he thought proper. Every man's interest would prompt him to seek the advantageous and to shun the disadvantageous employment. So I want to just discuss this, which is the basis of the labor theory of value in my view, in relation to the hub and spoke model. So what does it mean in the hub and spoke model? In the real world, when a producer chooses to specialize in some particular line of production, which we're thinking of as a spoke of this production wheel, she incurs effort costs, perhaps over her life cycle. She has to acquire skills, tools, knowledge, access to inputs, and then she has to expend effort in production itself. So there are all of these effort costs. these are the disadvantages of specialization in a line of production. And I want to emphasize here to start thinking about this in as broad a way as you can, not in as narrow a way as you can, which are frequently lumped together as labor effort or just plain old labor. So you think of what Smith called in that paragraph the disadvantages of production collectively are labor. They're the price, the cost of doing it. If producers are free to choose which product to specialize in, Smith argues that they will gravitate, given the assumption that all the spokes involve equal effort, to the product that has the highest money price. Because that's the advantage. The advantage in the hub and spoke model, once you have money, is that you get to sell your product for money. So that's the advantage, is the money price. This movement will tend to equalize the ratio of money price of different commodities to this broad concept of labor effort. That's the labor theory of value, in my view. So it has to do as much with the allocation of labor among the different spokes in order to meet the pattern of social needs, which in this case we made very simple because social need is just the same for all the producers and it's just this equal bundle of all of the products. And what I would argue the labor theory of value in the way that Smith thought about it and the way that Marx thought about it is that whole process taken as a whole. It's not just the part that has to do with the determination of the money price. It's the part, it is equally much the part that has to do with the movement of labor between the different spokes. In order to achieve an equilibrium in which all of the products are produced in the proportions necessary to meet social needs, the money prices of the commodities will have to be proportional to labor effort in this broad sense. And that's the substantive core of the labor theory of value. And the reason I'm bringing it up here is because I think this hub and spoke point of view, which we are looking at primarily because of our interest in the social interaction model, as a kind of byproduct, untangles some of the confusion and mystification around the labor theory of value. Now I'm going to move forward into the separation of sale and purchase. And I think I'll let a discussion on these things go till next week so that we can at least get the introductory ideas. So in order to apply the social interaction model to the hub and spoke system with money-mediated exchange. So from now on, I'm assuming that we're in the equilibrium with money, okay? And barter, it may exist around the edges of the system, but it's not too important. And primarily what everybody's doing is producing, selling their product for money, and using the money to buy the other products that they need as the method of instantiating the specialized division of labor. Each producer must also choose a frequency distribution, let's say, describing the frequency with which she chooses each line of production. So the first thing you got to do is say, well, my action is, first of all, I'm going to go to this spoke or that spoke or the other spoke with some frequency. According to the principle of labor theory of value, the typical producer will be indifferent among the lines of production so long as their payoffs are equal, their net payoff being the ratio of the money income to the effort in each of the spokes. Just as a test question, what is the quantal response in that case? If all the spokes have the same payoff, what is the frequency distribution with which the typical producer chooses each spoke? Jose? It's a Dirac delta. It's a Dirac delta. No, I don't think so. Well, let's go back. What is the Gibbs distribution? The Gibbs distribution says that you choose each spoke proportional to E to the payoff over some T. If Smith is right and the payoffs are all the same, uh, Juan. Juan says a uniform distribution, and that, I think, is the logic of it. Because as long as the payoffs are the same, you would put an equal weight on any one of them. And that's the labor theory of value again, if you want. Suppose for some reason we got stuck where one of the spokes had a higher net payoff than the other ones. Now your answer is right. If the temperature is zero, then you go to the Dirac distribution. Everybody would want to do that, right? Everybody would want to make shoes. If, however, the temperature is finite, is not zero, is non-zero, in fact, not everybody will go into shoe production. In fact, you'll get a distribution of the producers over the spokes according to the Gibbs distribution, and some of them will go to every spoke. So the F for each spoke will be finite. Okay. The typical non-money producer and the money commodity producers then decide how much of each of the other commodities they will purchase. So in terms of the social interaction model, the way we're going to think about this is we're going to think the producers set a money price. Here's how it works. This is the institution. If you look at Bowles's microeconomics book, you'll find that this particular case comes up over and over again. It's the basic case of simple monopoly. What the producer does is say, I will sell my product at this price, and I will sell you any amount, effectively any amount, at this price. And that's not so unreasonable because the producer has an awful lot of the commodity, actually, compared to what any one person, any one other customer is going to buy. So it's not so unreasonable. So we're in a world where the producer sets a price. And the question is, what price are they going to set and what's the consequence of that? So the average action of the other producers is the price they set. The setting that we're going to do now is suppose all the other producers, all of them, and since they're all symmetrical, it doesn't matter whether they're producing your product or they're producing their own products. It's just the same number. I mean, you could change that around. Suppose everybody else is choosing P bar. What is the price you would charge? This is the key question. And an equilibrium is going to be a P bar that has the property that when everybody else is choosing P bar, the typical producer also chooses P bar as the payoff maximizing action. But before we tackle this question of the determination of price, which is very interesting and maybe has a rather surprising outcome, let's first of all just think about how this economy would operate given any uniform price. So now let's suppose the auctioneer or somebody says, okay, P bar, everybody's going to sell their commodity at a price P bar. What's going to happen? Well, first of all, if all the non-money producers offer their commodity at this money price P bar, each money producer starts off by maximizing her payoff by buying the quantity, which we'll call XM as a function of P bar, that does what? Well, that equalizes the amount of the money commodity she retains with the amounts of the other K minus one commodities she buys. So if you're the money producer, you're saying, what are you thinking? You're thinking, I want to wind up with the same amount of all the commodities, because that's the complementary payoff function, right? The Leontief payoff function that we're operating with. So I want to wind up spending exactly the same amount of the money commodity, which I produced, as of every other commodity. All right, well, that sets up a definition of this XM P bar. How much do you buy? And the answer is this much. A, because that's how much of the money commodity the individual money producer produced. divided by 1 plus k minus 1 times p bar, because you're going to spend p bar on each of the other k minus 1 products. Or you could write it as a over x mp is 1 plus k minus 1 p bar. The payoff for the money producer would then be xmp bar, right? Because she has xmp bar of every commodity, including the money commodity, as a use value at the end of this process. Now, what about the other producers? Okay, so now you're a producer of some other good beside the money commodity. And the money commodity producer comes and buys xmp bar of your commodity, right? What do? Well, you divide that up among all the other commodities in as equal a fashion as you can. So on the first round of trade, you spend on each other commodity, x of p bar, you spend 1 over k minus 1, the fraction 1 over k minus 1 of your money income on that, given this scheme, all right? And this would work in the following way. Once the money producers bought their commodities, they would drop out of the process, right? Because they've got a balanced consumption bundle where the money commodity and all the other commodities are just equalized, right? On average, each non-money producer would then have A minus XMP of her own commodity, because she would have sold XMP to the money producer in her team, and P bar times XMP bar of the money commodity, because that's how much she would have charged for that sale, which we will arbitrarily assign. Now I've assigned it to the kth position. I got to straighten that out, whether it's the first. Think about it now at the end. On average, these producers would spend the money on some other commodity. So they go and they buy a certain amount of some other commodity they need in order to equalize her holding of that commodity with her holding of the money commodity. So once, she does the same thing in the next round. But at the same time, some other non-money producer would buy her commodity, right? Because these are all basically symmetrical story, renewing her holding of the money commodity. So although she spends the money commodity to buy something, somebody else buys some more of her commodity, and then she's back having the money commodity. But in each of these rounds, she comes closer to equalizing her consumption bundle, because each round she buys something she needs, something she doesn't have. At the end of the process, the typical non-money commodity producer would have the following bundle: A minus K minus 1 XMP bar. And then she has XMP bar of everything else, and she has P bar times XMP bar of the money commodity. Now, the key to this is the following fact. It's going to be a completely equilibrium phenomenon for a non-money commodity producer to wind up with too much of her own product. Why? Because it doesn't make any difference to her payoff, right? The only thing that makes a difference to her payoff is the minimum of all the stuff that she has. And if she has some excess of her own produced commodity, it's not going to bother her. She's never going to have an excess of the money commodity. Why? Well, suppose you're sitting there and you have a certain amount of all these other commodities. You have your own commodity. Let's say you have a ton of that in the back room, but you don't care that much about it. You have a certain amount of butter and cheese and blah, blah, blah. And you have more of the money commodity as a use value. What are you going to do? You really should, if you're following me, you really have to be able to answer this question, because well, what, when you have money, what can you do with it in this economy? You can buy, well, yes, in particular, you can buy from any other commodity with it, because the producers have agreed to sell it at this going price. So if you had more of the money commodity than, let's say, the average of butter and cheese and so forth, what are you going to do? You're going to buy a little more butter and cheese and so forth and push your money commodity down until they're all equal. So you will never be, you'll never have an excess of the money commodity. You'll never have an excess of any of the other commodities under this scheme, right? Except the one that you produce. Why are you going to sometimes get stuck with too much of the one that you produce? Can you decide how much of that to sell? Can you determine how much of that to sell directly? It's the other buyers who are deciding how much you sell of your own commodity. That's the social coordination problem. If you could coordinate with them and sort of sit down and agree, all right, you know, we'll all buy blah, 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 but that's not how this is working. How this is working is through this monetary exchange. Okay, now I'll just say one word about this and then we'll go over to next week and pick it up. What happens is that if P bar is bigger than one, then in general, everybody winds up with too much of their own produced commodity, except the money producers. The money producers don't have this problem because they can always spend, they can always use their own money commodity to buy something. So they don't have this problem. So a typical outcome, though, is that everybody has some surplus of their own produced commodity. They have exactly the same amount of everything else, including the money commodity as a use value, and that determines their net payoff. But there's nothing in this that guarantees that P-bar will be set at a level where you actually get all of the commodities produced traded. In fact, I will show that it's the only case where that happens is where P-bar is equal to 1. So if P-bar is equal to 1, then everybody's like the money producers, and they all get rid, they all reduce their own product down to this, to the average level, and then you get the socially coordinated solution. So now the question is P-bar equal 1 the equilibrium of the social interaction? Does anybody want to venture a wild guess? This is equivalent to the question, is money a veil? It's equivalent to the question, are the fundamental welfare theorems of general equilibrium theory applicable to this kind of scenario? Because the welfare theorem would say the invisible hand, does the invisible hand operate? I mean, the invisible hand operating should be that P bar equals 1 is the equilibrium of the system. Exactly. So P bar, so you've proved that P bar equals 1 is the socially coordinated solution. But you haven't proved that P bar equals 1 is the equilibrium of the social interaction. Okay, so we will, you can all look at this and find out how the murder mystery comes out. But okay, but that'll be it for